man. Robert Wood, take it away.
All right, guys. All right. I'm going to use this as my podium. We're ghetto faggots here at BG. Anybody check it out? All right. So, I, too, am like Hannah, an artist trying to travail the jungles of Hollywood. And I, too, am trying to do it with a broader perspective, a greater worldview, trying to see the bigger picture of it all and God's hand in it. And I spoke about almost over a year ago, and at that time I got to share my story, and just a little bit for you guys who weren't there. So I came to LA many eons ago, and I came here with a girlfriend at the time, and as soon as I landed foot, man, I was hooked. Like the glitz and the glam and the parties and the lifestyle. I mean, I wanted to experience it all, you know? So shortly after, I broke up with my girlfriend, and I started partying, you know? Started having a good time, you know? And I was even working a little bit. I was working as an actor and making money, and I was like, hey, this is pretty good. I'm enjoying life, you know? And then it all came to a screeching halt. No, literally. I was rear-ended twice in 2 months. In fact, I was leaving physical therapy from the first accident when I got hit again. And I thought to myself, I said, man, I think God might be trying to give me a wake-up call or something. And so I had a friend who was who's also an actor, and we worked on sets together. And he was always trying to invite me to his church. You know, you know that friend. You know, he's like, hey, man, you should check out my church, man. I think you'd love it. You know, or if I was going through something, he'd be like, hey, well, you know what my pastor says about that. He's like, I'm telling you, man, you got to come. I was like, dude, no, okay? Church is not for me. I'm good. But when I got hit that second time, I called him. I said, hey, what's up, buddy? How you doing? Yeah, I'm good, man. Hey, you still going to that church tonight? And so I went, you know. I went, and then I went again, and then I went again. And I really kind of enjoyed it. And I was started to, like, hear these messages about achieving success in the world versus significance for God. And how my life maybe was really not just one big meaningless party, but maybe God had a plan and purpose for my life. Well, I jumped in, and I was all in. But sorry, which I'll explain. So since that day, which was about 15 years ago, up to now, God has blessed me tremendously. I mean, I have been blessed with, like, jobs in like film and television and stage, working on jobs that I had no place being, being as green and unqualified as I was. But God, he offered those to me. He gave those to me, and I got paid, and I was blessed tremendously financially too. Not only that though, he spoke a word and vision into my life that transformed me from the inside out. Like he gave me a drive and a purpose and a confidence and a boldness. And you know, also though, in that same span of 15 years, I've had seasons of tremendous drought. I'm talking like months and months and months of no work. And this is at the same time trying to getting married and trying to start a family and having kids and just trying to make ends meet. You know, and it's in those times that you're barely hanging on to that word. You're barely hanging on to that vision. And doubt and confusion start to creep in. And then you don't know if you're hearing from God anymore. You don't know, or even more so, now I'm just being honest with you, you don't know if you want to hear from that God, because life is just so bad. I mean, it's just like stuff keeps coming one right after the other, piling on top of each other, creating this huge wall that you can't break through. And you just, life's not making sense, and you just want to run away. How many of us know the story of... Yeah, you feel me? Preach. Now, how many of us know the story of Jonah? Yeah? Everybody's heard the story of Jonah. Jonah's, you know, you probably heard that, you know, he's the guy who got swallowed by the fish and stayed in the belly 3 days and three nights. But there is so much more to that story than that. Let's go ahead and read Jonah 1. Can we put that up? Oh, you're brilliant. Okay. Jonah 1. Now the word of the Lord came to Jonah, the son of Amittai, saying, "Arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and cry out against it, for their wickedness has come up before me." But Jonah arose to flee to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. He went down to Joppa and found a ship going to Tarshish. So he paid the fare and went down into it to go with them to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. God is trying to warn Nineveh through Jonah. And Jonah ain't having none of it. I mean, Jonah is an Israelite, and Nineveh was a Gentile city. And not only that, Nineveh was part of Assyria. And Assyria wreaked such havoc on Jonah's country of Israel that Jonah believed that they deserved judgment. And so it didn't make sense to Jonah. Now, Jonah was actually the only prophet to preach to the Gentiles, and he did not want to comply. But that scripture says when you don't listen to God's word, you leave his presence. And that is a very lonely, hopeless place. But there's other parts of the scripture that say he never leaves us nor forsakes us. So this whole time, God is trying to draw Jonah back to him. Now, the means by which he does it is somewhat questionable to the natural mind. He sends a wind and a giant tempest to try to rip Jonah's boat in half. Then his crew turns their back on him and throws him overboard. And then God sends this giant fish to come and swallow Jonah to save him from drowning. And while Jonah's in the belly of the fish, he prays to God and thanks God for saving him and finally comes to his senses and says, you know, I'll do what is asked of me. So God goes and talks to the fish, and the giant fish swims to the shore and then vomits Jonah up. How's that for a wake-up call, huh? So, let's read on. Jonah 3. Now the word of the Lord came to Jonah the second time, saying, "Arise, arise, yo. Go to Nineveh, that great city, and preach to it the message that I tell you." So Jonah arose and went to Nineveh, according to the word of the Lord. Now Nineveh was an exceedingly great city, a three-day journey in extent. All right, now let me tell you something about Nineveh, okay? The book of Nahum says that Nineveh was a city full of lies and endless cruelty, a city of extreme pride due in part to its wealth and power. Now speaking to all my artists out there, does this sound like a place that you've dealt with on your journey to stardom and fame? Maybe just a little bit. Yet another translation of the word, exceedingly great city, it says, is a city important to God. Verse 4. And Jonah began to enter the city on the first day's walk. Then he cried out and said, "Yet 40 days and Nineveh will be overthrown." Okay, so here's Jonah, sent by God into this massive, seemingly impenetrable fortress, right? It says Nineveh's walls were 100 feet high and wide enough for three chariots to ride abreast. It was approximately 60 miles across, thus requiring 3 20-mile travel days. Okay, yes, so Jonah, you know, was probably happy, more than happy, to preach Nineveh's downfall. But don't you think that he might have been just a little bit intimidated? Like, so here's Jonah walking in, right? And he sees these walls 100 feet high. And he's walking in, and it's literally like a bunny rabbit going into a den of lions. He walks in, and not only this, he doesn't speak their language. They speak Aramaic. So he's busting out his ancient Google Translate here, and he's trying to find some short little phrase that he can phonetically translate and speak. Something real small, something that will get them going, but you know, just enough. So he's walking in, and these people, they don't look nothing like him. So already they're staring at him, and he walks in, and it's not the most comfortable place, and he's just, you know, trying not to make eye contact, just keeping his eyes, Google's Translate, and he's just like, for 40 days, and Nineveh will be overthrown. Yet 40 days, and Nineveh will be overthrown. Yet 40 days, and Nineveh will be overthrown. And I mean, come on, guys. This is like the first day, right? So he's got 2 more days of this to go through. Verse 5. So the people of Nineveh believed God, proclaimed a fast, and put on sackcloth from the greatest to the least of them. Whoa. Hold on for a second. Back up here. The whole city repented on the first day? Oh, my. Okay, well, how many people know that whom God sends, he thoroughly equips? Amen. And not only that, but the scriptures say that he goes ahead of us and prepares the way. Amen. Verse 10, then God saw their works, and they turned from their evil way. And God relented from the disaster that he said he would bring upon them, and he did not do it. Well, all right. Crisis averted. Decimation canceled. Nineveh's on board, right? But wait, no, the story's not done. See, God is trying to draw all hearts to him. He's not only concerned about the lost people of the city, he also is pursuing the servant. Chapter 4. But it displeased Jonah exceedingly, and he became angry. So he prayed to the Lord and said, "Oh, Lord, was not this what I said when I was still in my country? Therefore, I fled previously to Tarshish, for I know that you are a gracious and merciful God, slow to anger and abundant in loving kindness, one who relents from doing harm. Therefore, now, O Lord, please take my life from me, for it is better for me to die than to live." Jonah did not want the Lord to relent. He wanted God's wrath to be unleashed on Nineveh. So let me ask you a question. How many of us get angry and frustrated when we don't understand, or more so, we don't agree with what the Lord is doing in the world around us, or what the Lord is doing in our personal lives? And now, how many of us think and act irrationally in those times? Exactly right. I'm right there with you. Verse 4. Then the Lord said, "Is it right for you to be angry?" So Jonah went out of the city and sat on the east side of the city. There he made himself a shelter and sat under it in the shade till he might see what would become of the city. You see, Jonah's so ticked off here. He doesn't even answer God. He splits. He's like, "Yo, I'm out." He just leaves, fuming. And he's still confused, too. He's thinking, I mean, is God really going to show compassion on an enemy of Israel? This I got to see. Now, how many of us get ticked off and frustrated when we think we know God's heart or his intentions? And he seems to be doing the opposite. Or if we think we have a word from him, and it looks like it's never going to pass. Verse 6. And the Lord God prepared a plant and made it come up over Jonah, that it might be shade for his head to deliver him from his misery. So Jonah was very grateful for the plant. But as morning dawned the next day, God prepared a worm, and it so damaged the plant that it withered. And it happened when the sun arose that God prepared a vehement east wind, and the sun beat on Jonah's head so that he grew faint. Then he wished death for himself and said, "It is better for me to die than to live." Then God said to Jonah, "Is it right for you to be angry about the plant?" And he said, "It is right for me to be angry, even to death." You know, as I said at the beginning of my message, there have been times where God has provided me with a plant, with shade, with comfort, with sustenance, with tremendous blessing. And then there has been times where God has provided me with a worm, or permitted a worm, with loss, with pain, with discomfort, with unbelievable loss. And it's really hard in those times not to get downright angry. You know, when Sam first asked me to speak, I was pretty reluctant. I'm going through a very difficult season in my life right now. My family suffered tremendous loss in work, in income, with sickness, and death. I mean, just yesterday we went to a funeral, another one. And you know, it's in those times when it's incredibly hard to make sense of what's going on. And I mean, you know, we pray for all those victims and families in Florida, in Sutherland Springs, in Las Vegas, in Sandy Hook, in Columbine, and the list goes on and on. I mean, it's incredibly hard in these times to make sense of it all in our natural mind. But that's, you know, it's like Sam said on Friday, you know, there are no easy answers to this. But this is when I believe that we have to put our faith into action with our spiritual mind. You know, the scripture says that all things, good and bad, work together for good to those who love God, to those who are the called according to his purpose. And it's in these times that I think we need to stand on that belief that there's a greater plan at work here, far beyond what our natural eyes can see. I mean, otherwise, what choice do we have? You know, the scripture says, when all that is good falls apart, what can good people do? The Lord is in his holy temple. The Lord sits on his throne in heaven. God puts us in places where we have nowhere else to turn but to him. His ways are higher than our ways. His thoughts are higher than our thoughts. And for us to think like God, to try to make sense of this, in our natural mind, with our natural strength, to try to make sense of all the tragedies in our lives is just foolish, stubborn pride. See, God puts us in those places. God purposefully provides us with the plant. And He purposefully allows in the worm. And He does it purposefully because He loves us. And He wants us to grow and develop and mature so that we can go out into the world and be His hands and feet and help His people and rescue His lost sheep because He loves them too. You see, somebody out here needed to hear this message today. And as angry and resistant as I was not going to be able to thwart the plans and purposes of Almighty God. He relentlessly pursues each and every one of you with an unfailing love. You know, when I'm asked to do these kinds of things, I always try to be extra attentive to the Holy Spirit, you know, throughout the week so that I can make sure that I'm saying what God wants me to say, not what Robert wants to say, you know. And it's never an easy process. So, like, Tuesday rolls around, right, and I'm still not getting any clear direction. Like, I and Sam's giving me these talk points, and I'm looking at my notes, and I'm like, it seemed like they're going the other way. And so I'm starting to get a little stressed out here. I don't think this is happening the way that I saw it happening. So then Friday rolls around, right? And you know, the Olympics are on right now. So they're interviewing a lot of former Olympians. And my wife and I were watching this interview with Scott Hamilton. Anybody know Scott Hamilton? Scott Hamilton is a world champion and Olympic gold medalist figure skater. But he also is a cancer survivor who has lived with tumors in his brain all his life. And the interviewer asked Scott about, what can you say to people who have been praying for their tumors to shrink and their prayers are not being answered? And Scott said, the veil between us and God is thinnest in our suffering. I said, whoa, I grabbed a pen and jot that down. I was like, that's deep, man. And then so that was Friday. Then yesterday, I go to the funeral, and they give us these programs, right? And the program was the old Footprints poem. Who knows the Footprints poem? Come on now. All right, so the Footprints poem basically talks about, you know, they use it a lot at funerals, but it talks about a guy who goes through his life, and then at the end of his life, you know, he looks back and he sees two sets of footprints in the sand, you know, one for him and one for God walking by his side, you know. And so he's looking at these footprints, you know, in his dream. Come on in, have a seat. I warmed one up for you there. And so I was talking about this footprints poem. You know the footprints poem? Yeah, everybody knows the footprints poem. Some people don't have good memories of it though. So I was thinking, you know, they usually give it out at funerals. And so I went to a funeral yesterday, so I got one. So it's a collector's item. So I'm looking at this footprints poem, right? And it says that when the last scene of his life flashed before him, there was only one set of footprints. And he noticed at the very lowest and saddest times in his life, during the most troublesome times of his life, there's only one set of footprints. And he says, I don't understand why when I need you most, you would leave me. And the Lord replied, my precious, precious child, I love you and I would never leave you. During your times of trial and suffering, when you see only one set of footprints, it was then that I carried you. It's in your times of greatest suffering that God is closest to you. That God is relentlessly trying to pour his love into you. But now here's the part of the poem that kind of struck me, is that he still asks, where were you? He doesn't feel it in the moment. In that, in his suffering, while he was in it, he didn't feel the love. So where do we get the reassurance while we're in the suffering? Okay, I have the answer. No, I don't. No, I don't. God has the answer. So the last time I spoke at BG, right, God gave me a title immediately. Career versus calling, the art of letting go. And I was like, whoa, God, that is a title, man. I mean, it was like multifaceted, and like he was like streaming all these like different colors and shades in it, and it was like multi-layered, and I was like, this is an awesome title. I'm gonna be able to go so far with this. And so I'm praying to God, and I'm like, God, I gotta speak on Sunday. Give me a title. Hang on to your word. What was that? Hang on to your word. That's kind of basic, God. I mean, that's I don't mean to do your job here, but that's a little simple. I mean, that's I'm not really gonna have much. I'm not gonna be able to work much out of that. Hang on to your word. You know, why don't I go ahead and take hang on to your word, and I'm just gonna put it right here on the shelf, and I'm just gonna wait for something more magnanimous to come around. You know. But how many of us know that the God who sends the fish and the plant and the worm to get the attention of a man is the same God who calms the winds and the waves of the entire sea with just one word?
Amen.
So I get up this morning, right? Today. So I had a Friday occurrence. I had a Saturday occurrence. And now this is today. So I get up today, and I decide to go for a jog. You know, I'm gonna do this whole Joshua Jericho thing. You know, jog around the church seven times. I'm crazy like that. No, but seriously, I only made it around twice. So I got my jogging shoes on. You know, I got my headphones on. I'm listening to my streaming music, right? And this song comes on, and it just about drops me to my knees. And start weeping, because I looked up the lyrics. I'll share them with you. I could find them. My pet never come. There you go. All right. Sometimes it's hard to keep believing in what you can't see. That everything happens for a reason. Even the worst life brings. If you're reaching for an answer and you don't know what to pray, just open up the pages. Let his word be your strength. And hold on to the promises. Hold on to the promises. Jesus is alive, so hold tight. Hold on to the promises. In your times of greatest suffering, cry out to God, and he will give you a word. Or open up the scriptures, and he will give you a story or a verse that will speak right into your situation. And then, remember that word. Hang on to that word, because I guarantee you, you're going to need it again, either for yourself or a friend who's going through exactly what you're going through or already gone through and have overcome. And that's the person who could use that word. All right, let's finish up these last two verses. I went on a segue there into suffering and pain that I think we all needed a little bit of. So. Amen? All right, last two verses. Let's send this puppy home, Lord. So God's giving Jonah the plant, right? And then he takes it away with the worm. But he uses every single bit of it for a teaching moment, a wonderful teaching moment. Verse 10. But the Lord says, you have had pity on the plant for which you have not labored nor made it grow, which came up in a night and perished in a night. And should I not pity Nineveh, that great city, in which are more than 120,000 persons who cannot discern between their right hand and their left, and much livestock? God is saying, look, they can't even discern between their right and their left. They're helpless. I mean, they don't even know there's a way out, Jonah. And if they did, they couldn't find it. Shouldn't we help them, Jonah? And the book ends right there, hanging on that question. You know, I've been a part of the artist community here in Hollywood, our modern day Nineveh, for many years now. And I always say, I can't believe how people can make it through this industry, this business, without faith, without believing for a better day, without knowing that time and chance can happen to any one of us, without standing on the God's greater plan and purpose for our lives, and that he will use the gifts that he's blessed us with, and he'll allow us to use them for his glory. And then finding contentment with that. You know, because otherwise you're just like a hamster in a wheel. And you're constantly running. And you're trying to grab a bite of a job or of a paycheck or of an acknowledgement or a confirmation that you are good. And you know, these artists that, you know, hey, I'm still guilty of some of it too, you know. But these artists, they constantly ebb and flow. Their moods constantly ebb and flow from happiness to depression, happiness to depression, with every perceived success and failure. And in some circles, it happens on a much higher level. You see, there's this thing called the list. And if you're on the list, that you're a success, man. And if you're not, you're a nobody. And if you're on that list, then you're thrown into these environments, these high stress, high stakes environments where you sign these contracts for millions of dollars before you're even allowed to perform or show your skills. And then when you do perform, if you perform well or to their liking, then you're a success. And if you don't, then you're a nobody. This is the mentality of the artist going through this business without faith. Their sole goal and focus, their every waking moment is spent on trying to please people in order to obtain success, instead of trying to please God and freely receiving his significance. Speaking to all my artists out there, and you know, everyone in general, you don't need to be on that list. You are on God's list. You are on the maker of heaven and earth's list. You are on the man who lives on streets of gold and owns a cattle on a thousand hills list. You know, I got some great news to share with you today. God has opened some doors to allow us to begin to start discipling some of these artists, to start creating that talk with them. He's opened doors for us to start facilitating these workshops, donation-based and free workshops in dance and movement, in comedy and improvisation, in b-boy hip-hop, in b-boy and hip-hop, and he's allowing us to start to create these spaces of belonging for these very same artists. And I just want to applaud some of the facilitators and creators of these workshops. Michael J. Slav, Hannah Redlip, Shane and Stefan, hopefully, huh? Put you on the spot, you're now hired. And I want to ask you all, you know, first, can we get the band to come up? I'm sorry. I just want to ask you all, you know, now that we're done and everything, you heard the story, you know what it's all about. I just want to put it out to all of you, my beautiful gay family, as we reach out to our Nineveh, what kind of Jonah will you be? Will you be reluctant and resistant to participate? Or will you jump full in, head on, and take part in the great work that God will do through this movement, knowing full well that He will go ahead of us and prepare the way? And as you go, as you put your hands into helping us facilitate, and we're going to need all hands on deck, all right? We're going to need help. It's going to take all of us to facilitate these workshops and to even just take the classes. But you know, I'm believing that we're going to have such an influx of artists that there ain't going to be room for you guys.
Amen.
Amen. And as you go and participate and volunteer, God will pour His love into the hearts of the lost city. And He will also pour His heart into you, His good and faithful servant. Let's pray. Father, I thank You so much, Lord, that this was Your word. I surrender it unto You, Lord. I surrender it at Your altar, Father. I believe in faith that this is Your Spirit speaking today, Lord. If any words came out of my mouth that were me, strike them from their memory, Lord. Strike them from their memory. I pray that You open their ears to hear, and You gave them humble and contrite hearts to receive Your word. I thank You that Your glory will go forth in Hollywood, Lord. I thank You that You will be glorified in all of this, Lord. As we move forward in faith, Lord, that You will go ahead of us and You will prepare the way, Lord. Thank You, Lord, for transforming this lost city into what Your original intent of it was for. To shine Your light.